Hey everybody, thanks for being here. Today we're going on a very special trip to South Central Russia or Southern Siberia to fish the beautiful Ka-Xem River. I think you'll find this show very interesting, so stay tuned. I'm Justin Wolf, and this is Angler West Television. Places around the world, the fisheries are so damaged that catch and release is the rule. Or if you can catch one or two in a day, you're doing great. This isn't one of those places. We're about 30 miles from the Mongolian border in southern Russia on a tributary of the Ka-Xem River. Upstream from here, there is little to no human activity. The water at our feet is perfectly good to drink, and there is an enormous population of fish in this stretch of the river in front of us. Here, Andrei Parfenov is demonstrating a traditional fishing technique using a handmade planer board and multiple lines baited with hand-tied flies. The river is incredibly rich in aquatic insects, so the right fly pattern presented correctly will usually get plenty of attention from the fish. Russians and Americans have many similarities, and one of them being that we both tend to use the weather as an excuse for a slow bite. We've already caught plenty today, so Andrei will return this one to the river. Andrei is part of a group of family and friends that we've joined on this summer expedition to this very remote part of Siberia. We've arrived here by boat, and everyone has already been out for a morning of fishing with basic rods and reels. And the catch today, as every day, has been tremendous. While the ladies prepare the upcoming feast, everyone else works together to clean the day's catch. With three boats out fishing, that adds up to a bunch of fish. There's very little waste, as nearly the entire fish is used, including much of the innards, specifically the roe, stomach, heart, and liver, which will be incorporated into a very tasty soup, or simply brined in a little salt and eaten on a slice of bread, which tastes better than it looks. Another traditional way of preparing the fish is to smoke it using a carefully prepared green birch leaf fire. It's a simple process that takes less than an hour, but there's a fine line between not enough smoke and too much heat. But when it all comes together, the results are fantastic. It's safe to say that on this camping trip, no one will go hungry. Our journey here began several days earlier with a flight from the US to Moscow, where with a few hours to kill, we decided to join the other tourists to see some of the incredible historical buildings and sites in Russia's capital city. We're with myself, Doug Hayes, and Adam Hayes of Oregon Tackle, who were on their first trip to Russia. Moscow is a very old and interesting city with many layers of history, beginning in the 12th century, including the horrific wars and occupations of the 16th and 17th centuries, the expansion of the 18th century Russian Empire, the Russian Revolution and Soviet era, and the fall of communism to its present existence as the 14th largest city in the world.
Hey, do you know how to get to the Dalles from here? The Dalles?
Yeah, no.
No?
Dang it. I don't know how we're gonna find the Dalles from here.
From here, we're not looking for the Dalles. We're heading four time zones to the east to the city of Krasnoyarsk in the Siberian region of Russia. A city of well over 1 million people, Krasnoyarsk dates back to the early 17th century, and today is an important junction of the Trans-Siberian Railroad. It lies on the banks of the Yenisei River, the largest river in the region, with the production of aluminum being central to its economy. A logical place to build high-quality aluminum jet boats. We're at the Ka-Xem Boat Factory in Krasnoyarsk, run by Dmitry Karmanov, who has created a manufacturing process enabling them to build boats with a thickness of aluminum and structural strength not typically found in boats of this type.
It is very, very strong.
Yeah, with the two together, it's almost like tubing.
Yes.
Put the two together.
Ka-Xem builds these boats, or rather overbuilds these boats, specifically to handle the challenging rivers of Siberia. With some serious horsepower imported from America, these boats are built to handle whatever the Siberian wilderness can dish out, not only in terms of structural integrity, but also the ability to carry loads of people, gear, and extra weight, like 55-gallon drums of fuel, up the long runs of some of the most spectacular wilderness and fishing grounds found anywhere in the world. Welcome back to Siberia. I'm Justin Wolf. We've caught a flight from Moscow to the Siberian city of Krasnoyarsk, where we've met our host, Dmitry Karmanov of Ka-Xem Boats. And now we're on our way south on a full day's journey to the Ka-Xem River. On the way, we passed through some beautiful steppe country typical of Mongolia. We're still in Russia, but the culture is definitely a mixture of Russian and Mongolian. This is a farming region with long, warm summer days, and historically, the largest crop being hemp. In the 19th century, the U.S. was one of Russia's biggest customers for hemp, for producing sails and other textiles. The remnants of this farming era still grow wild along the roadside, but today is little more than something for American tourists to get a good laugh about. Soon we reach the mountain ranges of Irgaki National Park, the gateway to the Ka-Xem River, a beautiful alpine region in full midsummer bloom. There's vibrant color everywhere if you look, and there's also plenty to eat, with locals offering a variety of wild-picked fruits and berries along the roadside. In a few months, this will be one of the coldest places on Earth, but right now, it's just perfect. Farther on down the road, we reach a river valley of the Ka-Xem and the town of Sarik-Sep. Here, we will gas up the boat and maybe use the facilities. With all the tanks and the 55-gallon drum full, we'll make the Ka-Xem River to meet the rest of our party just in time for the sunset.
One, two, three, go!
Early the next morning, we christen the new boat, and after picking up the glass, load up for about a 50-mile run up the Ka-Xem River to our camp. We have three boats to launch, all with experienced drivers who understand the challenges of this river. Loaded down with people, supplies, and fuel, we head upstream in the peaceful lower stretches of the river, leaving signs of civilization behind. The Ka-Xem, otherwise known as the Little Yenisei River, is a tributary of the Yenisei River, so this water will end up flowing well over 1,000 miles to the north before it reaches its mouth at the Arctic Ocean. It's a beautiful volcanic landscape with small forests of birch and steep cliffs. Before long, we reach our first set of rapids, which are run with no problems. Unexpectedly, we find signs of human activity, with horses on the riverbank and fenced-in haystacks to keep out the native deer and moose. Living in this remote part of Russia are people known as the Old Believers, roughly comparable to American Amish, who live in extended family communes that resemble small towns. Being in the middle of Asia, far from any ocean, the climate here is not regulated by the heat of an ocean, so in summer it's warm, but in winter it's very cold with lots of ice.
Granite, and it was crushed 1 year or 2 years ago by ice. Every spring it's fresh crushed. And same side, this side. I cannot imagine what the force, what the force of ice.
Water in any form is a powerful force, but our boats are powerful as well and push us forward mile after mile over many rapids. A boat ride like this is unbelievably fun, and it just gets more exciting when you've reached the point in the river where there are no more roads or human development of any kind. Just the wilderness, the river, and all of the fish that it holds. After half a day of running the river hard, we come to an area of beautiful cliffs and forests that just feels like we're getting close to home. Ahead, the Ka-Xem splits into two smaller tributaries. The one on the right is not navigable, but the one to the left will become home for the next 6 days. It's a postcard location and a perfect place to camp. We're camping for several days on a beautiful tributary of the Ka-Xem River, which means we have plenty of time to explore and to fish these pristine waters that flow out of the Mongolian wilderness. According to our Russian hosts who have experience fishing this river, the most effective technique is to drift and cast and retrieve small spinners. This river is extremely fertile with huge numbers of fish, but they can be tight-lipped if you don't give them what they want. But with the correct presentation, bites are inevitable. Doug Hayes has hooked his first taimen, or more properly pronounced, taimen, which definitely is something to really get excited about. The taimen is the most prized fish in the water and are known to grow large, especially in certain rivers in Mongolia, where they are considered rare. But here they are smaller and more numerous and considered excellent table fare. Our party caught many taimen on this trip, releasing most of them, but keeping a few of the larger fish for the table. Taimen have an adipose fin, so they are a salmonid, but they really more closely resemble a pike in both appearance and habits. The Ka-Xem is one of the only rivers in the world where there are truly abundant, healthy populations of taimen. And of course, it's tradition that everyone must eat the adipose fin of their first fish.
You have to eat it, that's the door.
You must eat it.
You must
right
eat
there?
Yeah.
Oh.
No, that right there.
All except bones.
All except bones? No skin though, right?
Yes. Yeah, skin too.
What? Man. All of this.
You okay. Yeah.
You can't even bite it.
Taimen aren't the only fish in the river. The basic technique of finding a stretch of soft water, then drifting slowly with the current, allows you to cast a lure to endless targets around rocky outcroppings, deeper pools, or gentle riffles, where a variety of fish might be lying in wait to ambush minnows, aquatic insects, or any other potential food source that comes within striking range. Long casts and a fairly fast retrieve, just skipping the tops of the rocks, are most effective. This fish isn't a taimen, but a large lenok, otherwise known as a Manchurian or Siberian trout.
Mike, congratulations to you.
I think it's 3 kilograms. It's very big for Lenok. Very, very big for Lenok.
Adams makes mine look like a shrimp.
Similar in appearance and habits as a brown trout, the Lenok is an ancient species with a historical range covering much of Asia.
Nice!
Some researchers regard Lenok as the missing link between grayling and trout in terms of evolution. In the Ka-Xem, they are plentiful and a welcome addition to tonight's dinner.
Hey everybody, I hope you're enjoying today's episode from Russia. You know, this isn't the first time that I've traveled to Russia, and a question that I get from some Americans is, do you feel safe when you travel there? And the answer is yes. I've always had a great time, can't wait to go back. The thing is, I'm filming a fishing show, so I'm dealing with the fishing community, which is worldwide, and also the language that fishermen speak is also a worldwide language. And that reminds me of an episode I filmed years ago in Russia, where a high-level government official had a message that he wanted to send to Americans.
We're in St. Petersburg, Russia, with Russian outdoorsman Andrei Velikhanov, who is taking us to visit his friend at the State Assembly.
After an extended tour of the beautiful building, which is typical for St. Petersburg, Mr. Vladimir Barkanov, who is an avid sport fisherman, took us to the Grand Meeting Hall, where he wanted to send a message to American fishermen.
Hall for the state representative of the city of St. Petersburg and all lawyers are adopted here.
Которые живут и укрепляет, конечно, прежде всего эмоциональные дружественные связи, дружественное настроение по отношению между людьми. Это очень здорово.
And talking to the North Americans and other people in the world, I want to say again that the sport fishing is this such peaceful sport that connect people and make the relationship easy. Who is connecting people? It's not president, it's the fish and the normal people that talk to each other and make friendship. Let's fish together.
Now we're going back to the Ka-Xem River, but first I want to point out a few things. Now we're in Siberia, so you might think it's cold, but actually it was very warm and the sun is intense, so a good pair of sunglasses is critical. I found that the gray colored lens works out best for seeing into that water, and these coasters really did a great job for me. Now the Yeti Hopper is something that I didn't have on a trip because I didn't get it until after I returned, but I sure wish I had it on the trip. These things are great for taking onto a boat because they don't take up so much space and you can kind of tuck them into places where you normally wouldn't be able to fit an ice chest. And they're a little easier to carry around than a traditional ice chest, and they hold the ice just like you'd expect a Yeti to hold the ice. Now you saw some underwater video of a Taimen striking a lure earlier. You might be wondering how I did that. Well, it was with the Water Wolf camera. Now these things are great because you can tie them in line and actually cast them, and that's how I got that video of the Taimen hitting that spinner. You can also troll them, put them under a bobber, put them in front of a jig, jig them up and down and watch the fish hit your jigs, and that's a lot of fun. The critical thing about the Water Wolf camera or being able to see underwater like that isn't so much to see the fish actually hit the lure. Where you learn is when you see the fish reject your lure. And then you can figure out what the problem is. That's where I found it really valuable about this. So if you use this Water Wolf with a critical mind, you're really gonna help your fishing out. Now, one of my favorite things about this trip was the food, and especially the soups that we had. The fish soups were just amazing. Now here's a quick recipe on a traditional Russian soup that you just might like if you're willing to give it a try. We'll start with half of a fresh-caught hatchery steelhead, gutted, gilled, and washed with the bones left in. You don't have to include the head, but that's where the best flavor is, along with the backbone. Into the pot goes 5 or 6 whole peppercorns, 3 dry bay leaves, and 8 to 10 cups of water, depending on how thin or thick you would like your soup. The idea is to cook the fish while creating a broth to use as the base for your soup. Cook the fish on a slow boil until flaky, in this case about 20 minutes. Remove the fish and set it aside to cool. Now strain the broth, removing the peppercorns and bay leaves. Then return the broth to the pot and bring it to a slow boil. Now it's time to add the vegetables. About 4 cups of young potatoes, 6 or 7 young peeled carrots, 1 large chopped onion, and 4 or 5 chopped celery stalks. Cover and simmer for about another 15 minutes. With larger chunks of potatoes and carrots, you may want to cook them for a few minutes before adding the onions and celery. The important thing here is not to overcook the vegetables. Next, with a fork, separate the meat from the bones and add the meat to your soup, along with some salt to taste. For garnish, add fresh chopped parsley and fresh chopped dill, which will also be added as you eat the soup. Now our Russian fisherman soup, or uka, is ready to eat. Maybe we didn't exactly get the reaction out of our 12-year-old that we were hoping for, but actually, she ended up eating most of it and admitting that it was pretty good. Welcome back to the Ka-Xem River, where we're about to enjoy tonight's fish soup, made with some of the fish caught today. Today's soup has taimen, lenok, and the river's most abundant fish species, Arctic grayling. You might think that fish soup would taste fishy, but that's not the case when experienced cooks have access to fresh fish like this. Even the insides, when prepared properly, can add a little zing to the meal.
And like any time or anywhere you're able to enjoy a few days in the wilderness, the time just spent hanging out around camp can be very relaxing and enjoyable. And of course, the great food and pleasant company, topped off with a little Russian apple juice, makes for a great evening.
Beauty right there.
It's hard to imagine just how many Arctic grayling are in the Ka-Xem River. Many of our fish will be salted and taken home to be eaten over the winter. But when you're in the right area and have the presentation dialed in, a fish on every cast is possible. Grayling are powerful for their size, great little fighters, and excellent table fare. They are perfectly willing to hit a spinner, but for me, the more fun way to catch them was with a fly rod. The fish field 5-weight rod and reel were perfect for this river, which is extremely fertile with huge numbers of caddis and mayflies, and many other aquatic insects. The grayling want to feed, but they are also very wary. I found that if I didn't give them a perfect drag-free presentation, they would refuse, which made them a fun challenge. Matching the hatch is critical, and there is no doubt that they are the prettiest fish in the water. The Ka-Xem River and its tributaries are some of the most beautiful that I've ever experienced, and it's great to know that in our world, we still have unspoiled rivers with drinkable water and healthy populations of fish. Special thanks to Dmitry Karmanov and Ka-Xem Boats for making this incredible experience possible.
Thanks for watching today's episode. You know, without the support of the sponsors, the show would not be possible. So please thank them when you can. Now get out there and do some great fishing.